William McKinley, our 25th President of the United States, may not be one of the most well-known presidents, but he certainly was able to accomplish some things that are in place today thanks to his efforts. He was a very devoted husband, and that's one of the things that historians write most about William McKinley, his devotion to his wife Ida, who was suffering from health problems. He was also part of getting the International Court of Arbitration at The Hague together, and he began plans for the Panama Canal. Sadly, though, he would not be able to see some of these projects through to completion due to his assassination in 1901. Canton, Ohio's favorite son, William McKinley, was our 25th President of the United States. He is our favorite son, but he was not born here in Canton. William McKinley was born on January 29, 1843 in Niles, Ohio. He was the seventh oldest of nine children born to William McKinley Sr. and Nancy Allison McKinley. They lived in Niles until William was about 10 years old, at which point they moved to Poland, Ohio, about 10 miles away. And the reason was the education system was a little bit better in Poland than it was in Niles. And Mr. and Mrs. McKinley wanted the best possible education for all of their children that they could provide. So young William attended the Poland Academy until he was 16 years old. He enjoyed debate along with ice skating and horseback riding. And he graduated when he was about 16 years old and then went off to Allegheny College in Meadville, Pennsylvania. He was there just about one term when a combination of financial problems and poor health forced him to return to Poland, and there he worked several different jobs. He worked in the post office, he was a Sunday school teacher, and he taught school in a one-room schoolhouse. Now by this point, William was 18 years old, and the year was 1861, and that was the same year that the Civil War broke out. And he, and along with some of his friends, joined the 23rd Ohio Volunteer Infantry and went off and fought on the side of the North. He did serve for 4 years, the entire duration of the Civil War. He went up through the ranks rather quickly and spent most of his time as a commissary sergeant, ensuring that food and supplies and drinks got to the frontline troops. He was discharged from the Army in 1865 after the war ended, and then that summer he went to Albany, New York and attended the Albany Law School. He spent 2 years there earning his law degree, and in 1867 was admitted to the Ohio Bar, and that was the same year that he moved to Canton. And he came to Canton at the urging of two of his sisters, Anna and Helen McKinley, both very well-respected school teachers in town, and they came. William came here because there were a lot of opportunities for a young lawyer at that time. He met Judge George Belden and they formed a partnership, and in 1869 he was elected Stark County Prosecutor. Now shortly after moving here, he met Ida Saxton, who was the granddaughter of John Saxton, founder of the repository, and the daughter of James Saxton, who owned a bank in town. And Ida was working at her father's bank when she met William. And they courted. They would see each other on their way to church on Sundays, and eventually they got married on January 25th, 1871 in the newly constructed Presbyterian Church in downtown Canton. About 11 months later, they had their first daughter, a little girl named Catherine. She was born on Christmas Day of 1871. 2 years later, in 1873, they had another daughter named Ida, named for her mom. Sadly, though, both of the children would die at a very, very young age. Baby Ida died when she was not quite 5 months old, and then, unfortunately, Catherine died at the age of 3 and a half. Now, despite the personal tragedies, professionally, William McKinley went on to serve as Stark County Prosecutor. He was Congressman for Ohio, a role he served for 14 years. He was elected Governor of Ohio, and in 1896, with a successful front porch campaign held right in Canton, Ohio, he was elected our 25th President. He served until 1900, and he was reelected again. And unfortunately, he only served a few months of his second term when, on September 6 of 1901, he was attending the Pan American Exposition in Buffalo, New York. He was inside the Temple of Music, shaking hands with the public, when a young anarchist named Leon Czolgosz approached the president. Leon had a bandage wrapped around his right hand. That bandage was concealing a small 32 caliber pistol. When the president reached out to shake hands, Leon fired two shots. One shot went into the president's shoulder and another entered the president's stomach. They quickly rushed President McKinley to a nearby emergency hospital on the fairgrounds, performed surgery on him, got out the bullet in the shoulder, but they were not able to locate the bullet in the stomach. And unfortunately, that stomach wound developed gangrene, and the president died on September 14, 1901, 8 days after he was shot. Now, following a brief service for the president in Buffalo, New York, the casket was loaded on board a train and taken to Washington, D.C., where he lay in state. And then on September 18th, there was one final trip back to Canton. The train arrived at the train station on September 18th of 1901. The casket was taken to the Stark County Courthouse, where the people of Northeast Ohio had their opportunity to pay their final respects. On September 19th of 1901, the funeral services were held at the Church of the Savior, which was the president's church, and then after those services, the casket was placed in the Wordsworth. And that day, on the 19th of September, some of the president's friends and closest advisors, they started talking about plans to build the McKinley National Memorial. Now, Mrs. McKinley came to visit her husband just about every day at the receiving vault, and sadly, she passed away at the end of May of 1907 from a stroke and was not able to see the monument fully completed and dedicated. The monument was dedicated on September 30th, 1907, and about 10 days later, on October 10th of 1907, the president's casket, Mrs. McKinley's casket, and the remains of the two daughters were moved from West Lawn Cemetery and placed up into the monument where they remain today. And that monument serves as a beautiful tribute to the 25th President of the United States and one of Canton, Ohio's favorite sons.
President Hayes said that you showed an unusual and unsurpassed capacity for soldiering.
Isn't it wonderful that so many children come to visit us, Ida?
It certainly is. I've always loved children. I especially like to invite the youngest child to sit with me. There is nothing more special than rocking the little one. I recall your telling me how challenging it was to manage your own classroom, William.
I have great respect for the teaching profession. As you know, my sister Anna was an outstanding teacher and principal here in Canton. Although I only taught for a short time, I do recall that it was not an easy job.
Didn't you leave to help with the North's war efforts? The war between the states was a terrible conflict, and many of the soldiers were mere boys.
Yes. The Army has a way of making boys grow up quickly. I learned a great deal and made many lifelong friends during the war. But children should be permitted to grow in peacetime. That is my hope for America's youth. No more wars that rob us of our nation's greatest resource, our children.
I'm sure that the Pan American Exposition will be an outstanding display of American progress. However, I would prefer to remain here in Canton with our friends.
I have always loved fairs, and I am anxious to see the electrical exhibits in Buffalo. We have also been promised a private tour of Niagara Falls.
Do you recall the excitement in Philadelphia at the 1876 Centennial Exposition? And later at the World's Columbian Exposition in Chicago?
As a congressman, I worked hard to have that fair located in the Great Lakes region. Even though the exhibition opened to the public in 1893, 1 year late, the Ferris wheel and the other attractions were worth the delay. I attended the Columbian Exposition many times and marveled at America's achievements.
I am sure that Buffalo will be impressive as well. Fairs are a good opportunity for Americans to demonstrate their ingenuity. Still, I wish that you would reconsider the public reception plan for Buffalo's Temple of Music. Your advisors insist that it is an unnecessary risk.
Ida, I was able to survive the war between the states without the slightest of injuries. There is nothing to fear from the American citizens who disagree with me politically. Besides, World's Fairs are the timekeepers of progress. As president, I must be visible and accessible to the public at such events. Ida, we have guests. Welcome to our home. It has been some time since Ida and I have hosted visitors. Please make yourselves comfortable.
William and I do enjoy having visitors. As president, William receives guests from all over the world who come to meet and confer with him. May we offer you a cup of tea or coffee? We have some of that special coffee from the Danimer store over on Cherry Street. It is delicious, if I do say so myself.
I agree, Ida. The Dannemillers have quite a reputation for roasting some of the best coffee in the region. Perhaps you have heard that during the campaign, my opponents sometimes referred to me as Coffee Bill. Well, they were attempting to poke fun at my service in the war between the states. You see, my regiment, the 23rd Ohio Volunteer Infantry, was pinned down at Antietam Creek. As a commissary sergeant, I organized some stragglers to bring hot food and coffee up to our boys on the front lines.
President Hayes told me that the men were so inspired by William's bravery that they were able to drive the rebels from the creek. The boys in blue were able to stop Bobby Lee's invasion of Maryland that day and preserve the Union.
It is nearly time for me to address our visitors from Illinois. Well, they have traveled all night by special excursion train and have gathered out on our front lawn.
The Front Porch Campaign has certainly been good political strategy. Providing groups with inexpensive railroad travel has enabled large numbers of men and women to visit our friendly town. They are able to see our modest home and the way we live. I am also very happy to have you nearby, as I am not feeling well these days.
I know, Ida. My opponent, William Jennings Bryan, has traveled 18,000 miles and talked to nearly 5 million people. Now, I do not envy him all that time away from his family. My campaign manager, Mark Hanna, has the party passing out millions of pieces of campaign literature.
I think Bryan is too young and too inexperienced to lead our country.
The experts are predicting a close race. We'll have to wait and see. If it is God's will for me to be elected, I will be the next president of these United States. Remember that day back in 1867 when we met? I had just come to Canton at the urging of my sister Anna. She said there were more opportunities here for a young lawyer. I was at the church picnic when I saw you looking radiant in your white dress and asked my friend to arrange an introduction.
Yes, I do remember that day. I learned of your arrival while working as a teller in my father's bank. I was anxious to make your acquaintance.
We passed each other on Sunday mornings and nodded as we made our way to our separate churches. Finally, I began to court you, and in my heart, I knew our marriage was meant to be.
Our lives together have been an adventure, mostly happy, but sometimes sad. I mourn still the passing of our two dear little daughters, Katie and Ida, both taken from us at so young an age. But I glow with pride when I list your achievements, William. County prosecutor, United States representative, governor of Ohio, and now president of the United States. You are such an accomplished man.
Yes, Ida, we have had some difficult times, but still we can count many blessings. We've worked hard together to create our happiness and our success.
Ohio on January 29, 1843. He was raised with a large family. The parents were very religious. His father was busy making furnaces all over the state of Ohio, blast furnaces, to produce iron. William McKinley also was a student at the Poulin Seminary School. He moved there when he was 8 years old, and his parents were very proud of his school record. McKinley worked hard to please his teachers and his older sisters. His father not being home very much, McKinley was, some people will say, maybe a little spoiled, but he had to answer to some older sisters and his mother. The family was fiercely anti-slavery, and McKinley grew up with the idea that we are a United States, slavery is evil, and as president, of course, and as a young man, he fought in the Union Army, and later as president, he did his best to ensure that minorities got the rights that they were intended to get. But William McKinley was a postal worker for a while in Poland. He was also a teacher, and in addition to that, he got a law degree, but it was a Civil War record that was really outstanding. William McKinley served four full years in the Civil War, working in the commissary department at first. He was a cook and in charge of supplies. At the Battle of Antietam, he disobeyed orders twice to deliver food to Union troops that had been sent into battle by General McClellan, because they hadn't eaten, and even wounded men out on the battlefield. McKinley rode along a two-mile front with a team of horses.
Mr. McKinley, he didn't do no wrong. He rode on down to Buffalo, but he didn't stay too long. Hard times. The people, they came running round to see what had been done. And you have shot the president down with your Ivor Johnson gun. Hard times. The train, running on down the line, blowing out of every station. McKinley's a dying. Hard times. Now Roosevelt, he's in the White House, he's doing his best. And McKinley, he's in the graveyard, taking his rest. Hard times. Roosevelt, he's in the White House drinking out of a silver cup. And McKinley, he's in the graveyard, and he'll never wake up. Hard times. Mr. McKinley, he didn't do no wrong. Rode on down to Buffalo, but he didn't stay too long. Hard times. Thank you.
Let it hang down on me.
Thank you. go to Washington. Roosevelt in the White House, he's doing his best. He lay in the graveyard, he's taking his rest. He is gone, long old time. Hush up, little children, now don't you fret. You draw a pension at your papa's death. From Buffalo to Washington. Roosevelt in the White House, drinking out the silver cup. He lay in the graveyard, he never wakes up. He is gone, long old time. Ain't one thing that grieves my mind. That is to die and leave my poor wife behind. I'm gone, long old time. Look here, little children, spread to drift. You draw a painting at your papa's death. From Buffalo to Washington. Standing at the station, just looking at the time. See if I could run it by half past nine. From Buffalo Washington. Hey, the train, she's just on time. She runs 1,000 miles from 8 o'clock to 9. From Buffalo to Washington. Yonder comes the train, she's coming down the line. Flowing in my station, Mr. McKinley's a dime. It's hard time, hard time. You've done. You shot my husband at Ivy Johnson gun. Get mad to Washington. Docked on the horse, he tore down his mane. Said to that horse, you got to outrun this train. From Buffalo to Washington. Docked train to Randy, checked off his specs. Said, Mr. McKinley, better pass in your check. You're bound to die.